In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Please be seated. We heard in the epistle this day, I therefore beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith which you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, and it goes on and on. And that's our calling. And then we hear in the gospel narrative this day about the chief seat sitters. Who are they? They're Pharisees. They were probably the most pompous individuals in our Lord's time and era. He was in a house eating bread with them, and they watched him. You know, they were up to no good. They didn't even have to say anything. But he noticed also that they liked to find the best seats in the house and then grab them and sit down on them. Well, so Jesus told us the story of attending a wedding and knowing where one ought to place oneself in reference to other people. And he said some powerful words with that little story, that parable. When invited by anyone to a marriage feast, he said, go and sit in the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, go up higher. And he, for everyone who exalts himself, raises himself up, shall be abased, put down. And he that humbles himself shall be exalted, lifted up. Friend, go higher. If we do things the right way in this wedding feast called life, we will hear those words of Jesus in the end of time. Friend, go up higher. So how do we do that? I think that's a yearning of us all. How do we do that? Well, we help ourselves tremendously by possessing the most difficult of all virtues. What is that? Humility. And that's what Jesus was speaking of this day. Humility. St. Thomas Aquinas called it a moral virtue, consisting in keeping oneself within one's own bounds, not reaching out to things above one. That makes sense, doesn't it? Now, St. Francis, our saint for this day, said that where humility is present, annoyance is absent. That's good. That's true. Someone once said, and I actually know who that fellow was, but I can't remember his name. He wrote Peter Pan, okay? And he said, life is a long lesson in humility. And if we're kind of thinking about life and walking through life, we can understand what he was talking about. It's true. It's also our hope that our lessons in humility are not all public experiences. We'd like to understand that before we are in the public, huh? But it really doesn't matter. What matters is, are we becoming better servants of God? Are we loving and serving God and others more fully? That's our calling. That gives us the great seats in the kingdom of God. And if so, we are doing what we are called to do, loving and serving one another and God. And guess what happens when we do those things? Pride that the Pharisees had, pride loses its grip on us because we are too busy to even think of ourselves. We are looking rather upward and outward, up to God and out to other human beings, trying to serve them. And so joy and peace and love, steadfastness, long-suffering will not only become integral parts of our life, but we share them with others in the name of God, in the name of Jesus. So how does that work? How do we do that? Well, humility once again. Now, children help us with this particular thing. They are a lesson in humility. Remember in Matthew, Jesus said, he was talking about little children coming to him, and he said, whoever shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. You remember that? Why the praise of children? That's because they start out knowing they need their parents and others to make it in life. They know they're not self-sufficient. And so they rely on their parents and they love them. But they have a tendency to grow up. And it can be a blessing or not so much so. And in the process of growing up, they often mimic us big people, you know? And if we have children who see us and we're doing God's work, that's really good. But at times, they can end up concentrating on self-exaltation because that's the only thing that they see. And they see anger and frustration and things that are not all that good to be staining our children with. So rather than the acquiring the virtue of humility. Why do we do that? And why do the children then have to grow up and be like their last generation? Well, for adults, it's fear. It's pain, it's scars of love lost. I don't know. We don't have enough time to think about all of the excuses that we point to why we are not in love with God. Fear, pain, and all that stuff. Inability to find love of God and others. In other words, we don't hold God in our heart. We hold grudges oftentimes. That's not our calling. When we live life in total reliance on God, like a child, we have such conviction about the faith that we will gladly lose everything for the sake of God's greater glory, for the sake of the gospel of Jesus. None of that stuff will matter then. Things will be put into proper perspective through love, God's love, experienced and shared in our lives. And as children of God, once again, that's what we ought to be. Our life will be lived in such a way that when people come into contact with us, they will also encounter Jesus and the gospel. That's the life to which we are called. It is the life. There is no other worth spending ourselves for.